Good morning. Welcome to Earl Street Baptist Church. We're so glad that you are here to worship with us today. If you're a guest with us this morning, we want to extend a very special welcome to you. We are very glad that you've chosen to come and worship with us this morning. If you are a guest, we would invite you to look in front of you in the pew pocket. There are guest cards that are located there. We'd encourage you to take one of those guest cards out, fill it out, and then drop it in the offering plate when it's passed later on this morning in the service. We're just very happy that you're here to worship with us today. I want to remind you that our Operation Christmas Child Packing Party is taking place immediately following this worship service. It'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall. There'll be a light soup lunch, and then the packing of the boxes will commence. So if you haven't planned on joining us, they would love to have you come down there, have a light soup lunch, and then help them pack the Operation Christmas Child boxes that they have down there. And if you took a box home with you that you plan to pack and bring back yourself, just a reminder that those boxes need to be back by November the 20th. So if you've got them ready, you can go ahead and bring them back. If not, just make sure you have it by November 20th so we don't miss that delivery due date. This morning, the Strategic Planning Committee and the Stewardship Committee have some documents that they would like to present to you for your review. The Strategic Planning Committee has been working hard, and they are presenting their 2020/2021 strategic plan. The Stewardship Committee would like to present their 2020 church budget, and then they have a summary documentation that goes with it to help explain the budget. These documents are available for you to pick up. They are available in the vestibule if you choose to go out the front of the church. If you go out down the corridor here by the history wall, there are documents available on a table there in the lobby in the waiting area on the third floor. And then also there is a table with the documents on it in the lobby of the second floor down near the mission statement. If you don't get a chance to pick the documents up this morning, or you might be a person who prefers to look at documents electronically, there will be an e-blast going out tomorrow morning that will have all of this information and these documents attached to it. So pick one up today if you want to have a hard copy. If you don't have a chance to get one or you prefer to look at it online, that e-blast should be coming into your email box tomorrow morning so you can look at them there. We invite you to take them home, encourage you to look at them, and then be back this Wednesday evening when we have church conference. Church conference will be at 5:45. It'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall, and this will be your opportunity to ask questions and raise comments or questions that you have about the proposed budget, about the proposed strategic plan. There will be other items on the agenda, but these will be the two main items that will be discussed on Wednesday evening during church conference, so make sure you're here for that. And the next Sunday morning, we'll be voting during church conference here, brief church conference during both morning worship services. There'll be no discussion next Sunday morning, but we will be voting on each one of these documents independent of each other. So make sure you're here Wednesday evening. Make sure you're back next Sunday morning. And remember to pray for our church as we go through this important process. Now, as we get ready to move into our time of worship together, if you'll take your cell phones out, other electronic devices you might have, check and make sure you've put them on vibrate or on silent.
Thank you. Please join me in the call to worship. People are starving all around the world.
While we dress up and come to church.
Tears of sorrow as our neighbors lose loved ones.
But we are busy doing church work.
Hungry souls searching for spiritual sustenance.
We wait in the church for them to come to us.
But they don't come, and we don't go. Forgive us for developing a fortress mentality and hiding out in the church.
Teach us that the true church is people holding out our hands to grasp the hands of others.
The hands of the lost who need to be found, of the hungry who need to be fed, of the sorrowful who need to be comforted.
Of the dying.
Help us to show the way of Jesus by the way we live. Amen. In the name of the and presence of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us pray together. Yes, God, you are our God, and we bow in your presence in humility, thanksgiving, petition, and awe. Bless our gathering and our worship. Forgive our wandering and not caring. Help us to truly ask, am I proof that you are who you say you are? May our worship this morning help transform us so that when others see us, they see you. Yes, Heavenly Father, touch our hearts as only you can do so that we go forth in grace alone. In the name of the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen.
Everybody, how is everybody today? Good. Okay. Love God, love your neighbors, make disciples. That's the greater way, and that's what we've been talking about for the last few months. We've learned a lot about it, and hopefully we're all feeling a little more prepared to try and live the greater way. Now, I don't know about you, but the part of the greater way that makes me the most nervous is the making disciples part. Making disciples means helping other people become followers of Jesus. And to do that, we're probably going to have to talk to them about Jesus, and that can be hard, especially if they don't know anything about him. We just aren't always sure how to start those conversations. Sometimes they start easily, and that's great, but more often than not, we're just not sure how to bring it up. So today, I want to give you a little tip about making disciples. You can help someone become a follower of Jesus without saying a word. You can help someone become a follower of Jesus by being a follower of Jesus yourself, by setting the example. When you live like Jesus, people will notice. And when they notice, they're going to wonder what's different about you. And when they wonder what's different about you, they're going to start asking questions. And when they start asking questions, that's when you can tell them about Jesus. That's when God will give you the opportunity to share your love for Jesus and why he is an important part of your life. And hopefully, through those conversations, you can help make someone a follower of Jesus. You can make a new disciple. Live like Jesus and tell others about him. That is the greater way. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for these children. Thank you for loving us and taking care of us. We pray that you will help us to live like Jesus and tell others about him. Amen.
Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory, when I'm home where my soul belongs? Was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song? I want to live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand. Recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I want to live like that. I want to live like that. Am I proof that you are who you say you are? That grace can really change a heart? Do I live like your love is true? People pass, and even if they don't know my name, is there evidence that I've been changed? When they see me, do they see you? I want to live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand, recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I want to live like that.
Tomorrow is Veterans Day, and in a spirit of worship and thanksgiving, we want to take a moment to give thanks to God for those who have served our country and have served us by serving in the military. So if you are a veteran of any branch of the military, I'd like to ask you to stand and remain standing as I lead us in prayer. We are so grateful to you for your service to our country and to all of us. Let us pray. God of grace and peace, on this Veterans Day weekend, we give you thanks for those who are standing here and now, and for veterans all over this land who have unselfishly and courageously served our nation in the past and have protected and defended our freedom. We pray for those who have fought, whose spirits and bodies are scarred by war, whose nights are haunted by memories too painful for the light of day. And we pray for all those who are serving our country now in places throughout the world, especially those who are in harm's way. As we pray for them all, we especially remember to pray for those who are related to our church family: Drake Curry, Jackson Darling, Derek Hawkins, Ellis Hendricks, Zach Jordan, Eric Paris, Vincent and Emily Pozzello, Rob Perkerson, Ben Reed, and Stephen Wilson. Lord, we ask you to shield them from danger and bring them safely home, and give their families here peace as they hope and wait and pray for that day. Bless all our veterans for the hardships they have faced and for the sacrifices they have made for a cause greater than themselves. And help us, we pray, to be united with them in our quest for freedom and peace. We pray in the name of the one who is our freedom and who is our peace, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the many blessings you have given us and for the blessing of being able to come to church to worship you today. We especially thank you for your unconditional love for us, and help us to worship you by spending time with you and by sharing your love with those in our lives. May these offerings be used to tell the world that we love them, but more importantly, that you love them. In Christ's name, amen.
I know I always say this, but the music, the children's sermon this morning, the reading, everything, the prayers, it's already preached the sermon. So thank you to everyone who's participated and made it so meaningful already. But let's press forward. Our scripture passage this morning is from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 4, verses 2 through 6. If you don't have a Bible with you and would like to follow along, we have pew Bibles underneath the pews there. And this passage is on page 1032. As I read, listen for God's word for you as an individual and his word for us collectively as a family of faith. Colossians 4, 2 through 6. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly, as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward those outside the church. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. This is the word of the Lord. Well, if you have been with us recently on Wednesday nights for our midweek recharge, you may recall that in our large group session at 6 o'clock, and this is a little advertisement for that, our topic is disciples then and now. We're looking at the first 12 disciples then, and thinking about our own lives as disciples now. One of the things we discuss around the tables on Wednesday nights is the idea of being a disciple of Jesus. A disciple, by definition, is a student or a learner or a follower. When we think of ourselves as followers of Jesus, some questions arise. And one of the most basic questions is this: what does life as a follower of Jesus really look like? What are the most important things a disciple of Jesus should be doing? At Earl Street, we answer these questions this way: as disciples of Jesus Christ, we aspire to live the greater way. Have you heard that before? The greater way is a life modeled after Jesus himself, a life that seeks to imitate Jesus. And it's based on his two great commandments, to love God and love our neighbors, and his great commission to go and make disciples. Loving God, loving our neighbors, making disciples, we believe that those are the essential elements of the Christian life. In fact, we believe these principles are so fundamental to living as a follower of Jesus that we have drafted this Greater Way Covenant, spelling out what it might really look like in our lives to live this greater way, and promising to God and to each other that we will try, as individuals and as a family of faith together, to really live this way. And so this fall, we've been preaching through the details of our Greater Way Covenant. We began the series by talking about what it means and what it looks like in our lives from day to day to love God. And then we explored how to love our neighbors by actively and intentionally seeking them out and serving them. A few weeks ago, we made the transition from loving our neighbors to making disciples by focusing on getting to know our neighbors and then building meaningful relationships with them. And this morning, we continue looking at this process of making disciples with three specific calls to action: showing our neighbors the way of Jesus by the way we live, praying for our neighbors, and seeking opportunities to have spiritual conversations with them. Did you hear those three things in the passage I read earlier from Colossians? It's not a very long passage, so I'm going to read it again. As I do, listen for these three things: being examples, praying, and having spiritual conversations. Paul writes, "Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. And pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly, as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward those outside the church. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone." Did you hear those three things? Examples, prayers, and spiritual conversations. When Paul wrote this letter, he was in prison, and it appears he got word that there was trouble brewing in the Colossian church. Some kind of false teaching had broken out that focused on human tradition or elemental forces rather than faith in Christ alone. In his letter, Paul turns the Colossian Christians' attention squarely back to Jesus. In chapter 3, he reminds them that they have been made alive in Christ and that they should set their hearts on things above where Christ is, not on earthly things. And then later in chapter 3, he says, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other, forgive one another, and over all these virtues, put on love." It's as though he's telling them to keep the main things the main things. And the main things are loving Jesus and loving one another. Does that sound familiar? And then, when we pick up in chapter 4, where we read, just before he winds up the letter, Paul gives the Colossian Christians some final instructions about making disciples. Be wise in the way you act toward your neighbors. Pray for God to open doors for our message. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be full of grace and seasoned with salt. That's the last nugget of instruction he gives them before he signs off. As you are loving Jesus and loving others, don't forget to make disciples. And here's how you do it: examples, prayers, and spiritual conversations. I mentioned earlier that in our sermon series on our Greater Way Covenant, Stephen's last sermon made the transition from loving our neighbors into making disciples. In terms of action, we focused on moving from merely getting to know our neighbors through serving them to building meaningful relationships with them. And today, there's another transition that's happening in this process of making disciples. In the context of the relationships we build with our neighbors, we begin to teach them how to be followers of Jesus. And I think, as Bethany mentioned in her children's sermon earlier, this is the point in the Greater Way where many of us start to feel anxious. If we're honest, the thought of teaching somebody else to be a follower of Jesus, especially somebody outside the church, somebody from our neighborhood, or our workplace, or our school, or our gym, can make us a little uncomfortable. Stephen, a few weeks ago, mentioned the E word, evangelism, and the anxiety that it can cause us. A story is told about the famous evangelist, Dwight L. Moody. In the latter part of the 1800s, he preached the gospel to tens of thousands of people. He accomplished many great things for the kingdom of God and no doubt led thousands to faith in Christ. The story goes that as Moody was walking down a Chicago street one day, he saw a man leaning against a lamppost. The evangelist went over and gently put his hand on the man's shoulder and asked him if he was a Christian. The fellow raised his fist and angrily exclaimed, "Mind your own business." And Moody replied, "I'm sorry if I've offended you, but to be very frank, that is my business." He was in the business of being an evangelist on a very public, large scale. And I think many of us are wary of the E word because it conjures up images of confronting strangers or having to shout through a megaphone at somebody. We're not all Dwight L. Moody's, but we are in the business of evangelism. But for most of us, evangelism happens in the context of relationships. That's what the greater way is all about. Loving our neighbors by serving them, then getting to know them, then building relationships with them, and then in the context of those relationships, teaching them how to follow Jesus, how to be like Jesus. As I mentioned earlier, a disciple, by definition, is a student. So it follows that the process of making disciples necessarily involves teaching and learning. We teach others to follow Jesus by both the things we do and the things we say. We teach indirectly by example, and we teach directly through spiritual conversations. Let's look more closely at what Paul has to say about the matter. He says, "Be wise in the way you act toward those outside the church, those who are not believers. Make the most of every opportunity." What does it mean to be wise in the way we act? It means knowing what to do when there is no script to follow. It means being tactful and thoughtful and creative. It means showing people what Jesus looks like in our everyday lives. It means giving them something to imitate. In 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "Imitate me just as I imitate Christ." That's a picture of discipleship. That's what it means to be an example for our neighbors, showing them Jesus in the way we walk and talk and live our lives at home, at work, at school, in the grocery store, at the gym, at the ball game, giving them something to imitate. But for the process to work, we must first be imitating Jesus. And that's what it means to be wise in the way we act. And Paul says, make the most of every opportunity. When God opens the door for us to interact with our neighbors, we trust him enough to engage in meaningful conversation. And what instruction does Paul give about that? He says, let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt. So we want our speech to be salty. Now, we have to be careful with our usage here. The word salty, as it concerns speech and attitude, has several meanings. For young people these days, including the ones I live with, salty means angry or upset, or maybe even downright mean. Somebody's salty. For those a little older, salty might conjure up the image of a coarse old sailor using profane language. Now, Jan Brown talked about this very thing a couple of weeks ago in our Disciples Then and Now group. It's a good reason to be there. Paul here isn't talking about surly young people or profane old sailors. He's talking about seasoning, the way the right amount of salt enhances food and makes it taste better. A little pinch of salt even enhances the sweetness of a dessert. If you watch any of these cooking shows on TV, one of the most fundamental mistakes a chef can make is failing to salt a dish properly. Paul is saying that when we talk about Jesus and our faith in him and spiritual things, what we say should be as appetizing as possible. When food is not salted properly, it doesn't taste as good, and we don't want to eat it. It's unappetizing. And our speech works the same way. When it has the right amount of salt, it's more appetizing, and people are more interested in it. I find this to be a refreshing way to think about evangelism and making disciples and talking to our neighbors about spiritual things. And I don't think it's just because it's about food, although I'm sure that's part of it. Think about it. How can we find ways to talk about our faith and talk about Jesus in such a way that it has an appetizing flavor to it? How can we talk about Jesus in such a way that what we say makes people want to experience him for themselves? And the answer lies in developing our own appetite for Jesus. You notice we talk about things that we enjoy and that are good tasting to us, things that satisfy us. We tell people about them. And spending time every day reminding ourselves why the gospel tastes so good is so important to salting our own speech. Some of us who have been following Jesus for a long time can lose sight of just how satisfying he is. We stop enjoying him like we once did. And it's hard to salt our speech with the flavor of the gospel when we haven't been enjoying the taste ourselves. So we need to make time every day to savor Jesus, to search Scripture and search our hearts for reasons why he is the most satisfying thing that we can ever experience. And Paul adds a nuance to his instruction about salty speech. He says, "Let your speech be full of grace and seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone." Now, at first glance, this part seems really intimidating. So that we may know how to answer everyone? There's no way we can have all the answers. But I don't think Paul's point is that we should have a specific answer for every question that somebody might bring up. I like the New Living translation of this phrase. It says, "Let your speech be full of grace and seasoned with salt, so that you will have the right response for everyone." It's not that we know all the answers. It's that we know the person we're talking to well enough to know how to respond to them in a meaningful way. Every person is different, and every situation is different. We can't have some kind of canned thing that we use. We can be honest if we don't know every answer. The key is knowing our neighbors and speaking with grace and salt about what Jesus means to us and what he has done for us. And then we can have an appetizing flavor to what we say about Jesus and having faith in him. And then overarching everything else, Paul says to pray. Well, he doesn't just say to pray. He says, devote yourselves to prayer. This whole greater way of living must be saturated with prayer. Paul's language here is extreme. He's talking about a life steeped in prayer. He says to pray that God will open a door for our message. He says to pray that we may proclaim that message clearly. He says to be watchful and thankful as we pray. See the picture that emerges? We pray for God to give us opportunities to teach our neighbors about Jesus, to open doors for us. And we watch for those opportunities and pray that God will let us recognize them when they come. And then we pray that God will give us the wisdom and grace to communicate in a meaningful way, that our speech will be appetizing. And we pray with thanksgiving, recognizing that we have been saved by the grace of God and the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And we're so thankful that we have a strong appetite for Jesus. And that comes through in the way we talk to our neighbors. Ultimately, it is God who does the work of the greater way. To the extent we are transformed or our neighbors are transformed, it's not because of our own skill or prowess. It's because of His grace and His power. And this mindset does several things. It puts our focus where it belongs, on God and not on ourselves. It gives the glory where it belongs, to God and not to ourselves. And it puts the pressure where it belongs, on God and not on ourselves. We can turn our anxiety about evangelism over to God. He can handle it. We don't have to worry about our performance in disciple making. We make ourselves available, and He will do the work. And then we will give Him the glory for it. During our time of commitment today, I invite you to commit yourself to the greater way of living. And perhaps the first step for you is starting a relationship with Jesus. I invite you to come. And as Psalm 34 says, taste and see that the Lord is good. He is good. And maybe you have been following Jesus for some time, but your appetite for Him has diminished. I invite you to come and rekindle your relationship with Him. Maybe you sense God calling you to join our church family. We would love for you to join us, and we'll do everything we can to make you feel at home. Whatever your situation is, I invite you to come or respond right where you are. Our pastor Stephen will be here at the front to receive you as we sing.
We pray.
as you go, go in peace, sharing the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit wherever you go.